Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to today's discussion on the American Academy of Arts and Sciences' latest report, Civil Justice for All. I'm pleased that so many from the law school community could join us for this essential conversation on the civil justice gap. I'd like to start by welcoming faculty and students from law schools in the Academy's affiliate program. We are very grateful to the over 80 universities who provide crucial support to our organization as affiliate members. The Academy and its affiliates are bound by a shared commitment to the vitality of higher education and the value of research. And today's briefing is a wonderful illustration of the power of this network. I want to thank the university presidents and law school deans who have embraced this report and made today's discussion a priority for their communities. Civil Justice for All is the latest publication from our Making Justice Accessible initiative. The project was co-chaired by Ken Frazier, chairman and CEO of Merck & Company, John Levy, chairman of the Legal Services Corporation and partner at Sidley Austin, and one of today's speakers, Martha Minow. To complete this report, a group of nearly 100 experts worked together over a three-year period because they were convinced, as this report says so clearly, that equal justice is a right, not a privilege. The American Academy was formed in 1780 by John Adams and other of our nation's founders to guide a new country through challenges and ensure that it would emerge stronger, even from times of great difficulty. This is one of those times, and the work of this report could not come at a more critical moment in our nation's history. For too long, the civil justice gap, the difference between the number of Americans who need civil legal assistance and the very few who receive help of any kind, has been allowed to widen. And the events of the past 6 months have only exacerbated the problem as our nation faces a new wave of evictions, healthcare disputes, employment issues, and other problems related to civil law. We hope that this report and its clear and concrete recommendations helps to close the gap so that every American, irrespective of income, will have access to legal advice and assistance when they need it most. Today's program will focus on the role that law schools can play in this effort, and we have put together a tremendous panel of experts to help us think together about some concrete ways to address a true crisis in American law. We have reserved time for questions from the audience in the latter half of our program, and I encourage your participation throughout the program. Please use the Q&A box found at the bottom of your Zoom screen to submit questions for the panel, and feel free to share your impressions or other observations in the chat box. It is now my pleasure to introduce our guide through today's conversation, Martha Minow, the 300th anniversary university professor and former dean of Harvard Law School. Martha?
Thank you, David, and thank you for your leadership and support of this effort and to the Academy. A veteran obtains legal help and then gains the benefits to which she is entitled but had not been able to secure for a decade. A lawyer helps a child with disabilities gain services and educational programming, and then the child progresses to the next grade with success. Similar needs and possibilities exist across fields, including housing, domestic violence, access to emergency assistance, and the need is enormous. We are facing a tsunami of evictions with the ending of moratoria that were adopted across the country during this pandemic, and the job losses that have also contributed to massive difficulties for so many people. People face 6 months or more of delays in getting access to the benefits made available by governments, and now the federal funding has ended. Domestic violence is spiking as people are trapped in small spaces with their families. School access crises, I think we all know about those. There are key roles played by many, many people. None of them have been sufficient. And we're focusing today here on possibilities for law schools, which have been key contributors in three ways to meeting the massive need: in delivering services through clinics, in training students who go on to full-time and pro bono work, and in devising new models, technologies, and practices. Without doubt, we're hoping that this event can deepen and encourage more efforts along these lines. Given the massive scope and variety of the civil justice gap, we realize that lawyers can only be part of the remedy. And the report that we are responding to and expanding today expresses a recognition that many others can and must help. Legal services, legal resources must be integrated with health systems, libraries, social services. And there are many people who are not trained as lawyers who could provide crucial help as individuals try to navigate the difficulties in their lives. This project reflects at least 30 months of work of reviewing the difficulties and also the promising innovations. We do see the benefits of meeting the needs. Every study that we reviewed found at least 4 times the value put in to legal services in the return, simply in dollar terms, and many found more than that. Critically helped by Lincoln Kaplan of Yale Law School and John Tessitore, associated with this academy, the report reflects work of co-chairs, leaders, and participants in working groups, lawyers, law students, researchers, and many, many more. I can tell you from experience, it's a great resource. It's excellent for use in law school classrooms and clinics, and indeed to share with alumni. We hope it's a call to action, and we hope to invite every law school to deepen the ways in which law schools deliver service, train students, and develop innovative models. As we explore the possibilities here, there are 7 different recommendations in the report. And they include the 7th, a call for ongoing action to identify and publicize effective innovations. You'll hear about many today. And we also hope that there will be an ongoing effort to teach and infuse knowledge and motivation to tackle the crucial challenges in access to justice in this country. As we come closer to another anniversary of this country's founding, will we live up to the ideal of equal justice for all? I'm delighted that we are joined here today by Dean Andrew Perlman, the co-chair of the working group in innovation on our project. He has led efforts both at Suffolk Law School and in the bar across the nation on innovation in the delivery of legal services. And he's one of the most influential and effective leaders in this effort. Quinten Steenhuis, who is a clinical fellow at Suffolk Law and a creator of digital tools, including one that helps pro se tenants. He's developed open source user-facing technology and other innovations. We're joined here also by Tonya Brito, who co-chaired our initiative with regard to family law. Tonya is the Jefferson Burris Bascom Professor of Law at the University of Wisconsin Law School, also associated with the Institute for Research on Poverty at the University of Wisconsin, an award-winning teacher and scholar, national expert on the intersection of family law and poverty law. Dean Dayna Matthew, the Dean and Harold H. Green Professor of Law at the George Washington University Law School, and a leader in public health and civil rights law, who focuses particularly on racial disparities in healthcare. She co-founded the Colorado Health Equity Project, a medical legal partnership incubator that exemplifies the kinds of partnerships called for in our report. Chief Justice Margaret Marshall, internationally known not only for her hundreds of opinions for the Massachusetts Supreme Judicial Court, including the ruling that made Massachusetts the first state in the nation to legalize same-sex marriage, her work on and off the court to improve access to justice for all is legendary, and her efforts to make the judiciary more transparent, efficient, and accountable inspire us all. So, with no further ado, we turn now to Dean Perlman.
Thank you so much, Martha, for the introduction, and thanks to you for your leadership on this particular initiative. Thanks also to the American Academy for its terrific work on the report and the efforts to get the words out about its important recommendations. So I'm going to focus my remarks on just one of the many ways that law schools can help to address the access to justice crisis, namely by teaching students how to deliver legal services better, faster, and cheaper through legal innovation and technology. Here's the problem as I see it. The longstanding solutions to the access to justice crisis, namely increased pro bono work from lawyers, more funding for civil legal aid, and efforts to establish a right to counsel in essential civil matters, also known as civil Gideon, are all important, but they have proven over decades to be inadequate and insufficient. We need new ideas about how to deliver legal services to the public, but law schools aren't helping matters because we typically teach students to engage in highly customized and expensive forms of lawyering, leaving our graduates ill-equipped to keep costs low and increase access to the legal services that the public desperately needs and that Martha so beautifully described. This problem is deeply rooted. For more than a century, law schools have relied on essentially the same educational model. The model requires students to read court opinions, extract from those opinions basic legal doctrines and principles, and then apply those doctrines and principles to new fact patterns. In recent decades, law schools have certainly and very usefully supplemented the traditional so-called case method by teaching a wider range of skills. For example, most law schools now offer clinics where students learn important lawyering competencies while representing clients under the supervision of experienced clinical faculty. Law schools also have introduced more legal research and writing instruction, various types of simulation courses, and other opportunities to gain practical experience. Some of these efforts, especially clinical programs, as Martha explained, have even helped to increase access to justice by representing members of our respective communities when they might not otherwise have access to a lawyer. But here's the point from my perspective. The standard law school curriculum, even with all of these additions, contains a critical omission. It fails to teach students how to deliver legal services efficiently. Instead, most law schools continue to teach a predominantly bespoke model of representation in which each client receives highly tailored and time-consuming assistance that is necessarily expensive. We typically teach a turn over every rock, dot every I, and cross every T form of lawyering. An alternative is possible. We can teach our students how to use legal innovation and technology to increase access to legal information and services. For example, one law school, Chicago Kent College of Law at Illinois Institute of Technology, partnered with the Center for Computer-Assisted Legal Instruction in the early 2000s, this is nearly 20 years ago, to create a web-based platform called A to J Author that allows legal professionals to prepare online guided interviews for self-represented litigants. The guided interviews consist of easy-to-understand questions that, once answered, produce automatically generated legal forms. By 2018, more than 3 million people had used an A to J Author guided interview and generated nearly 2 million court documents. Other law schools are beginning to engage in conceptually similar work. For instance, at Suffolk Law, where I'm the dean, you can see it behind me, we created a legal innovation and technology concentration, kind of a law school major, which was the first of its kind in the country. We have courses in process improvement, legal project management, design thinking for lawyers, coding and the law, lawyering in an age of smart machines that teaches document automation, all of which help our students learn how to deliver their services more efficiently so that they can reach more members of the public. We also created the Legal Innovation and Technology Lab. We call it the Lit Lab, a new kind of clinical program that helps organizational clients such as courts and legal aid offices make more efficient use of the limited resources that they have. Illustrative Lit Lab projects include a TurboTax-like interface that helps tenants generate declarations to their landlords about a range of housing law-related issues. My colleague, Quinten Steenhuis, will describe this project in more detail. Another illustrative project is one our Lit Lab director, David Colaruso, is advancing with funding from Pew Charitable Trusts. It's called SPOT. It's basically Google for legal search. For example, someone might type, I'm getting kicked out of my apartment, and then receive information about eviction as well as available eviction-related resources in that person's jurisdiction. It also can be used by legal aid providers and nonprofits as a free triage tool, allowing them to address more of the public's unmet legal needs. We also established a first of its kind 3-year course of study called the Accelerator to Practice Program that teaches students how to use technology and cutting-edge law practice management tools to start or join law firms that can sustainably represent underserved clients. And finally, we launched an online certificate program that can benefit everyone in the legal services industry, including legal aid offices, by teaching them the knowledge and skills they need to help more people with the same existing resources. These kinds of programs teach students skills that will be helpful to our graduates in at least 2 ways. First, it will make our graduates more competitive regardless of their career paths, because clients and legal employers of all kinds increasingly expect them to know how to deliver legal services as efficiently as possible. And secondly, and I think here's the key point for today, this training also will help to reduce the cost of legal services for everyone, including for those who currently do not have access to legal services because of the expense of the bespoke legal services delivery model that students have traditionally learned, and because of the lack of resources that have been made available to those who have unmet legal needs. So that's my take on one of the ways I think law schools can help. I'll turn it over back to Martha and then on to Quinten.
Thank you so much. Very inspiring. Quinten.
All right, I'll go right in. Thank you. Imagine that you are sitting outside the courthouse. You had been living with your domestic abuser for the last few months, isolated back in April, and you made the choice to go to the courthouse to get help, but the doors are locked, as you can see here. You wait for hours outside, and then finally a clerk comes to you with a stack of papers for you to complete on your own. This isn't a hypothetical. This is what really happened to a legal aid client in Massachusetts. And it is a problem that was foreseen by our late Chief Justice Gantz of the Supreme Judicial Court when the COVID crisis happened, and he put out a call to action. Suffolk Lit Lab answered that call. The pandemic's been an accelerator for the work that Dean Perlman mentioned and really transformed it to be a pandemic response, to try to help people access the courts. So students and volunteers from Suffolk and from around the world, over 5 continents, helped Massachusetts unlock paper processes and turn them into step-by-step, mobile-friendly guides that can be delivered at the end of that process straight to the court. We started with emergencies in housing and domestic violence. We have found that this has been really a tremendous learning opportunity for our students. Students and volunteers worked with experts to take a process that was on paper and break it down step by step into a way that someone could answer easily online on their own. Automating a legal process means a lot more than just understanding one single fact pattern. You have to understand all of the fact patterns and the way that the tool interacts with the facts that your person who's in front of you actually has. And often what we found is that when you're automating a legal process like this, you discover inconsistencies and nuances that the original drafters of the form or statute might have never even considered. What we've done in our project is we've really streamlined and reduced the time that it takes to automate a form from start to finish and made it easy for someone to drop in with whatever skill set that they might have, whether that's as a subject matter expert, whether it's a student who can do a little bit of legal research, or somebody who has done a little bit of coding or started from no coding and has gotten a little bit of our training to help them get to that next step to be able to participate in the automation of these forms. I'm going to show you one of the projects that we did and how it connects with the project and the work that the Lit Lab at Suffolk has already been doing. So you can see here on your screen an example of Spot, which is a legal issue spotting API that Suffolk's Lit Lab built with funding from Pew. And let me just launch this. You can see what it looks like. And this is not on our live site right now. This is a demonstration, which is why you see this red warning label there. But the tool is actually in use and available to be used in several contexts. So let's start by describing what our problem is. We're going to talk about an eviction problem that we're facing. And then I'm going to click the Find Help button. And it is now trying to analyze my text. It's using artificial intelligence matching to figure out how similar my problem is to different problems that it knows about. And it's identified that it's a housing problem. And I'm going to go straight to the tool that we just talked about, which is this eviction moratorium assistant, which helps somebody who wants to know if they qualify for the eviction moratorium that the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention issued in September. So amazingly, a form like this is something that we were able to produce in just a day after learning about the moratorium order, because of all the work that we'd been doing leading up to that, to automate, to make our processes repeatable and sustainable without requiring a lot of individual effort each time. This is a very short and simple form to take you through it all the way. And you can see the power of this kind of tool and how it can help somebody who's facing a legal problem. What we've done is we've taken a lot of dense legal boilerplate that the order had and that the form that's produced has, and we've made it step-by-step and fact-based, so someone who can answer them without having to understand everything about the law. You can put just-in-time help and assistance to answer questions that they might have. This particular form does not include any videos, but you could easily include videos and images that might help somebody answer their question as well. I'm just going to go through one of these. This was one really dense sentence that you might have had to check on a form, but we can make it much easier for someone to understand what the different kinds of areas of need that they would have to qualify for this moratorium. And with a tool like this, you can really replace all of the aspects that someone would have if they're being helped in person. You can literally, we have people using tools like this over Zoom or sometimes just on a phone call to try to get that back and forth. And what happens when you finished it, if you're helping someone else fill it out on the other end, you actually have the ability to mail that, send it by text or email, right for them to add their signature and for them to verify that everything looks correct. We're able to translate a tool like this into multiple languages. This one's in English and Spanish. There are features like text-to-speech, which allow people who have low literacy.
English.
To be able to access the forms for people who have low vision. And this is just to show you the ability that you might have to text it to somebody to add their signature. But we're going to go ahead and sign it on the computer. At the end of a process like this, somebody could take and download a form like this and print it on their own. Or perhaps they want to send it right to their landlord by mail, by email, and they can click a button to do that as well. And the output can look whatever it needs to look like. So in this case, we've added a cover letter to the official declaration that the Centers for Disease Control created, and the person's information is filled in the right place on the form. So tools like this can be a really important part of the solving the access to justice gap, just like traditional clinics. And I think the difference here is scale. A form like this one that we created, it was something we could respond to in a day as soon as the order was released. And was used more than 1,000 times in the first week. We're now several thousand people have used the form across all 50 states. And that's the kind of scale that you can't get with one-on-one assistance. And that's the really crucial part of solving the access to justice gap. Now I'm going to turn it back over to Dean Minow to introduce the next speaker.
Thank you so much, Quinten. That's just incredibly inspiring. And you can see the power of scale, as well as the important point you made that working through these processes exposes the failures or inadequacies in the forms and in the processes themselves. We're so glad now to have Professor Brito who will talk with us about her work and her vision. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Martha, and thank you for inviting me to participate in this event. I do want to acknowledge the work of the Academy and this whole team of people who contributed, but also my co-chair for the Family Law Working Group, Professor Lance Liebman, and the members of our group more broadly. Today, I'm going to talk about what law schools can do and innovations in this area. And one of the innovations I would very much encourage law schools to consider would be sort of a small I innovation, and that really is introducing elements of access to justice in the family law curriculum, both in terms of teaching, but also in terms of teaching students about their professional obligations. One of the challenges in civil legal access to justice questions is that our legal education doesn't really teach students about what the experiences are like for people who are experiencing in the family law area these kinds of problems. And one reason is the information simply is lacking in family law textbooks. Although textbooks have evolved over the years, and certainly they're much improved now as compared to when I started teaching over 20 years ago, they still really are primarily published judicial opinions that have been issued by courts at the Court of Appeals or Supreme Court level, primarily by state court justices in the family law area. And at best, you might get maybe some statistical data that reports on the dearth of representation in family law cases. And that's useful for students to know, but they really don't understand what the experience is like for individuals who have family law issues and can't access courts or lawyers. With the case method, we're primarily looking at these judicial opinions, and they are primarily going to be explications of the law, the parties' positions, the court's reasoning, evidence that was relied upon, all of the things you would expect. And sometimes it'd be a more in-depth analysis of the broader social context with which the case is decided. This method is wholly inadequate to address the civil justice problems in family law, because they don't provide students with a real understanding of cases that don't get to a court of appeals or Supreme Court decision. Most civil justice cases in the family law area don't get litigated to that degree. Most people don't have lawyers. When we think about the legal system, we have to keep in mind that there are different, essentially, tracks of cases. And you might think of it in any number of ways, for example, corporate cases and cases involving more affluent litigants. And then on the bottom, there's this group of low-income pro se litigants. And their proceedings are primarily in municipal courts, primarily in lower courts, sometimes before commissioners, sometimes before magistrates. And their cases are really operating underneath all of that and on a parallel track. Their proceedings are, for them, obviously very highly consequential, painfully consequential. However, for their cases, it's a notable lack of what I might call transparency and accountability in those courts, because they're largely invisible and hidden from view because they aren't being appealed to reach a formal written judicial opinion, and they don't end up in our textbooks. And so we're not really teaching our students about what those experiences are like, and they're not really necessarily as well prepared to develop interventions to reach their civil justice problems. Without a review of those decisions at the appellate court level, we're also not developing and generating a jurisprudence of law that addresses their legal problems. That the cases tend to be more one-off decisions by individual judges or commissioners that are likely ruling from the bench and then issuing a one-page opinion that often is a form opinion, a check-a-box type opinion. And so we don't even have a civil record that we can rely upon that will tell us the details about what happened in those cases. We don't even usually have a stenographer there or even an audio recording of those cases that we can rely upon and draw from to understand how those cases are transpiring and how people are self-representing and how the legal system is operating in those cases. And so one of the things I really want to encourage in terms of what law schools can do is to be more intentional and deliberate to bring those experiences into the classroom and into our teaching, so that we're not just addressing cases that result in a published opinion, but also these civil justice experiences that affect pro se individuals and lower income individuals. I also just wanted to talk a little bit about law school clinics at University of Wisconsin. We're very fortunate in that we have a number of really quite excellent clinics. And in the family law area alone, we have four clinics that address family law issues. We have a family court clinic, provides assistance to unrepresented family law litigants in our community. We have another clinic that's called the Family Law Project. This group works with individuals who are incarcerated and helps them to establish and maintain family ties and also assist them with legal issues that really fall at the intersection of family law and incarceration. We also have what's called the VOCA Restraining Order Clinic. And here we're providing direct legal representation to victims and survivors of intimate partner violence. And we also have an immigrant justice clinic. The primary work done there is representing individuals in immigration proceedings, but they also provide ancillary assistance on things like domestic violence cases as well. And briefly, I want to talk about another innovation that I would encourage law schools to get involved in. Earlier, there was a mention about providing students with opportunities to learn how to launch their own practice. And at UW Law School, we have in our community, what's called a community justice incorporated. It's a small legal aid organization that is a nonprofit law firm, not connected to Legal Services Corporation, however. And it was launched in 2004 by four graduating students from the law school. Three of them were students that I knew from my family law courses, and they talked with me and consulted with me. And I know they talked and consulted with a variety of people who supported them and encouraged them to launch this firm. They fall into the category of what we call nonprofit sliding scale law firms. And they in part charge fees to clients, and they each have their own, and there are many across the United States, but they are a growing field to address the civil legal needs of low income individuals. And so each firm has their own arrangement of what kind of fee structure they represent, often having certain degrees of costs associated with salaries or assets, et cetera. But the point I want to make is that the innovation here is that this is something that can be created with support of law schools in a more instrumental role rather than simply supporting this wonderful inspirational idea of students themselves. And at UW, we do have a course we've offered that helps students launch their own firms. Many of us are practicing in parts of the country where we have small firms, we have sole practitioners, and often those law firms are serving members of the community. They're not all serving corporate clients. And I think law schools have a role to play in helping to foster and develop and support the development of these alternative ways of providing assistance to clients. Thank you.
That was terrific and so vivid about how to make the classroom really a window onto the needs and how to give opportunities for students while in law school and in their lives afterwards. That's just fantastic. And I know that your law school has made such a big difference here and you have done so as well. Dean Matthew, we're so glad you could be here and I turn it to you.
Well, thank you so much, Martha. I have to tell you, you've given me a very hard task to follow Quinten and Tonya and Andy and so many of the wonderful examples that they have given. I have just joined GW Law, as you heard in the announcement. And so I'll talk a little bit about this wonderful school and what we are doing to increase access to justice. But before I get started, I do want to say thank you. Thank you both for the privilege of being able to participate today and for being able to participate in this report. Thank you to the National Academy, to John Tessitore, to Dean Perlman, also to the co-chairs of the health group. My remarks will be focused on that part of the report, John Levy and Allison Rice, and to my dear friend Ellen Lawton, who is here at GW with me, I think for just a moment longer. It's fitting that this report uses words in the introduction that sound dire and urgent. Urgent is used to describe the need for prioritizing the need for access to justice, Crisis is the word that's describing where we are in legal services. These are areas that touch the lives of Americans every day. And so it is important that we as law schools think of how we can contribute to these dire, urgent, and important priorities. I would like to focus my attention on our responsibility to address structural inequality and the version of structural inequality that we have heard called structural racism. And I'll focus those remarks with respect to the health issues that we see today and that are addressed in so many of the 7 recommendations from this report. The COVID crisis, as we all know, is an awesome example, and I mean awesome in the most terrible way, of inequality in America. It's a scorecard, if you will. It's a way to quantify the extent to which justice and equal access to justice is in fact not the realized reality in the United States of America today. Why is it a scorecard? Well, because as you already know, I'm sure, the morbidity and mortality rates that have affected Black and Brown people, particularly descendants as I am from African ancestors, are abysmally disproportionate with respect to this virus. I don't need to tell you the numbers. You hear them every day, and I'm sure that many on this call are familiar with those numbers. But they are not only markers of a disease, they are not only markers of a difference in access to healthcare. I would like to suggest in my 2 or 3 minutes that they are a marker of the disparate access to justice, to civil justice in particular, that we experience here in the United States, and that law schools are particularly well situated to address. I say this because health and health outcomes are a quantifiable example of the social determinants of health. I'm sure that's familiar. I'll use one of my moments to just say social determinants of health are where we eat, work, and play. They are the ways in which place matters much more than your biology, your genetics, even your access to healthcare. What do I mean by that? Your housing is a social determinant of health. How healthy your house or your access to education, your access to food is a social determinant of health. So then it is fair to say that all of those social factors, which are both organized by and distributed by law, which are corrected when they are mal or disproportionately distributed by law, are indicators of how we have come to the place in our COVID pandemic where the disproportionality by race and ethnicity is so high. Why is it that if you are Native American, Alaskan American, you are 3 times more likely to be diagnosed than whites with COVID? Why is it that you are 5 times more likely to be hospitalized? And if you are Black, over twice more likely to die from COVID? Is it because of simple underlying medical comorbidities? No. It is because of the social determinants of health that are organized by law. Enter the medical legal partnership model and other models that could address these structural inequalities that result in the disproportionality that we are seeing evinced in the COVID crisis. So let me just say that what we see in COVID is not a new inequality. It is an uncovering, or rather a manifestation, you could say a metric, of the structural inequality in housing, in education, in income, in wealth, in food access, in recreation access, in access to environmental spaces. All of these inequalities are what create the comorbidities that have produced the inequity in death and dying that we're seeing in the pandemic today. And these are structural issues that law schools could be particularly helpful in addressing. So in the report, you had an opportunity to see an example of medical legal partnerships that were highlighted as ways to address inequality, and I would submit to you on a retail level. That is to say, most of the 400 or 450 medical legal partnerships today do a fantastic job of addressing individual cases of housing or eviction problems and communities that have need of immigration correction or finding status for people who are out of status in the United States, finding ways to to address not only housing problems, but problems for veterans, problems for educational opportunities, students who need IEPs, issues of domestic violence. These are vital issues. And in the medical legal partnerships that we started in Colorado and in the 450 around the country, the students are doing a magnificent job of addressing these on an individual basis. What I would like to suggest law schools could do today is to help students begin to address these on a structural basis, to do the kinds of things that some examples of medical legal partnerships have already undertaken. Examples like Emily Benfer, who is now visiting at Wake Forest, but who has done an incredible job of systemically and structurally opposing evictions around the country, who has also partnered with Senator Dick Durbin in order to change the legislation and the regulatory codes that are responsible for setting threshold levels of acceptable levels of lead in lead paint for children. These are structural issues, and it is structural inequality that I think we as law schools could do a much better, much more aggressive, much more systemic job of addressing if we want to address the crisis in civil access to civil justice. I'll close with a quote from President or former President Jude Gilpin Faust from my alma mater. She talked in 2010 about the purpose of higher education. And I'd like to suggest that this is the purpose of higher education and more so of legal education. That is, indeed, she said, as other institutions falter in dispiriting succession, universities nurture the hopes of the world in solving crises and challenges that cross borders, in unlocking and harnessing new knowledge, in building cultural and political understanding. She closed by saying that the university, and I would substitute the law school, will nurture hope, solve challenges, and model a path forward for building cultural and political understanding if we will help students who come into our halls with grand ideas in their admission statements about changing the world, saving the poor, and improving lives for many around the world, if we would help them leave with those same dreams and those same aspirations being realized in a structural way, I think we could significantly and substantially improve the problem of the crisis of access to civil justice today.
Thank you, Dean Matthew, for that inspiring and also very pointed call to action. Absolutely crucial to keep in mind. We need work at both the retail level and the structural level. Thank you so much. Chief Justice Marshall, bring us home.
Thank you so much, Martha, and to all of the panelists who've delivered remarks today. I know there are people from across our wonderful nation who are listening in today, and some of you are law professors and many of you are law students. I want to remind you how far we have already come. When I was a student at law school, and it was decades ago, there were very, very, very few clinics at any law schools. I mean, law school was really purely a sort of intellectual in the classroom, reading case books and so on. The very fact that we have established clinics at every law school, as far as I know, throughout the United States is just a breathtaking change. What made that so important? People, I believe, decide to become lawyers because they want to do good in some way. They want to make ours a better world, a better nation, a better community, a better state. And by providing law students with opportunities to break out of the academy in ways that are carefully matched by the academy. I don't mean the Academy of Arts and Sciences, I mean the university academy, was a wonderful way to help students think through what was helping in real life. All kinds of clinics up and down every kind of range that you could think of. There used to be one for civil legal assistance when I was at law school. Now there's a plethora of them at my law school. Why is this so important? Because I think the tactile exposure to what actually goes on in a courtroom teachers are wonderful students, young, middle-aged, old, everybody comes back to law school. The many, many ways in which we can deliver access to justice on a more, with a band that is deeper and wider. For example, many of the suggestions that you've heard today and that are in the Access to Justice report suggest that lawyers don't always have to do it. I agree. But lawyers have been crucial in helping court systems. And as the Chief Justice of Massachusetts, I was responsible for running the judicial branch, can help us teach court systems what adaptations they can make so that we could embrace many of the innovations that you heard about here today. Lawyers do not need to do everything, but we lawyers are very protective of our profession and we are hesitant to make changes. You, this generation, can help. My generation, for example, when I was listening to Quinten, I was in awe of how he was flipping backwards and forwards and screens and so on and so forth. Well, I couldn't do that. We didn't have the internet. We didn't have LexisNexis or anything else when I was at law school. There are so many opportunities that we can grasp here. I want to tell you one of the best things that happened to me this week. I live in Massachusetts. I live in Boston. So that's on the east coast of Massachusetts. And there's a long straight line that goes from east to west, from west to east. It goes all the way to the New York State border. It's an interstate highway. And as I was driving there and back this week, there were great big highway signs, blinking lights all the way along this highway that said the following: need help with rent, call 211. Need help with rent, call 211. It was startling. What was that? That was the outcome of a massive effort undertaken by law students, law professors, people in the community, the Chief Justice, the governor, to help people with their rent payments as we come to the end of a moratorium on evictions in Massachusetts. Coming together, we can make such a difference. What we need from this generation of law students, what we need from this generation of law school leaders, is the willingness to think differently, to do it differently, to make sure that we really can expand access to justice. People often say to me, why is the United States so litigious? I don't think we're litigious. I think we are a society deeply rooted in the rule of law, and that we like to solve our challenges through the courts rather than at the end of a barrel of a gun. We have built that system very slowly over several hundreds of years. Two steps forward, one step back. Three steps back, one step forward. Unless we, you, can find ways so that people who want to turn to the courts can turn to the courts and can turn to the courts in a way that solves their problems, I think we will be undoing a great deal of the work that we've done over the past 100 years. Thank you, the American Academy for Arts and Sciences, for embracing this extraordinary challenge to our society. And my thanks to all of you for listening. Thank you, Dean Minow.
Thank you so much for that inspiring story and image of the flashing light. And how can we make the flashing light a sustaining beacon? I will just point anyone who's participating to the chat that at the very beginning has a link to the report. Behind me, my background is a cover of the report. We are committed to making this a report that doesn't sit on shelves, that instead inspires and guides action. And that's why we're so grateful to those who are here today. There's time now for questions and comments. One says, I love the premise and the idea of making legal services more accessible to the underserved. Of course, every new initiative from a law school standpoint requires institutional resources and institutional buy-in. What are your thoughts, if any, on making the case to your law school about the importance of these efforts? We have two deans. We have a law professor, we have a chief justice, we have a participant in a law school. What are your thoughts about making the case to your law schools?
I'll take a shot at answering that question. I see it as having two parts, especially if the questioner was directed at the legal innovation and technology work that I was describing in mine. So I think the two parts of the question were institutional resources and institutional buy-in. So with regard to institutional resources, at least in terms of legal innovation and technology, we found it surprisingly easy to get off the ground. We are fortunate to be in Boston, where there were a lot of good adjuncts that we could draw on, but we also had some native expertise on our faculty. And so for them, it was really a commitment of time. So for those of you who are deans out there or in law schools and thinking about building out a program along the lines of what I was describing, I'd be happy to guide you on how you could do it, at least initially, with modest resources. And then in terms of institutional buy-in, that can be tricky, although I got some great advice from Richard Susskind a number of years ago, who's a great legal futurist and legal innovator. And he said, create something that's kind of a parallel track of innovation that doesn't necessarily require everybody to do something differently, but something that's a bit of a pilot off to the side that you could use to demonstrate its effectiveness, the value to students, the impact it has on graduates and their ability to find jobs. And then as you build it out and can show that it's successful, that might attract donations, grant support, as well as additional internal support within your law school. And that has certainly been the case, I think, at Suffolk. So for those of you who are interested in building out something along these lines, feel free to reach out to me and I'm happy to offer more details.
That's terrific. Next question is a great one too. Should law schools be providing training to another type of student who may not earn a traditional law degree, but will go on to work as practitioners focused on reducing the civil justice gap?
Well, I will take a crack at that, Dean Minow. This is a dangerous example of having just enough knowledge. I arrived at the law school deanship 2.5 months ago, and I have an opinion already. So let me say that the answer to that, in my opinion, is yes. I think that one of the things that we would make a mistake to do is believe in any one of our sectors or domains of society that there will be a quote unquote return to normal after the COVID crisis. In fact, there will be a new normal. We have changed in ways that we will not and perhaps should not go back. And certainly I think that's true for legal education. One of the ways that we have changed is to discover that it is not anathema to go online. It is not impossible to create an educational product that is competitive and compelling. I will admit that we still have learning to do and improvements to make. But once we do that, we can make that education more accessible. And we can make it broadly accessible to people who may or may not want solely a legal degree. In fact, that's one of the 7 recommendations in the report, that we look for not only lawyers, but lawyer extenders. In my field, we call them extenders, medical extenders, would be people who have other degrees, but that can extend the services, especially for pro se clients in many states, including the one I used to practice in Colorado. Representation by paralegals, by people who have legal expertise because they've been clerks of court. But can help advise, not the unauthorized practice of law, I understand, but that can help advise and extend the access to those services is something that law schools can participate in providing, I think, especially in this new online format. And I think that is a way to address the crisis in access and to do it in a way that makes for many, many more people to have not only access to justice, but access to good careers.
It's fantastic. And there are, as Scott Bales notes in our communications here, several states, Utah, Arizona, Minnesota, that have allowed or are considering pilots for licensed professionals who can provide just this kind of help. I think, Dean Matthew, we are so lucky you are now in the leadership role. I think that we will only go forward. We have allied medical professionals. Surely we can have allied legal professionals. Any big law firm understands that and has a variety of people working to solve people's problems. And the same should be true for low-income people. I couldn't agree more. We have a good question that I'm actually going to direct to Tonya, if that's okay. The question is that the terrific innovations today seem to depend on technology, but not all lawyers have deep tech skills. And you have ideas how to promote innovation without the need for deep technological knowledge.
Yes, I understand the concern about maybe some challenges in either gaining access to the technology or feeling comfortable using technology, particularly for people who might be a little more senior or might be in areas of the country where they don't have good infrastructure to support that technology or worried about the cost of technology and maintaining it and upgrading it in response to the evolution of the law. So technology may not solve all of our problems. I do think, though, in terms of being creative and responsive, we do need to think about ways where we can simplify procedures. There are many cases, particularly in the family law area, where we don't need full-on representation, but we need to think about ways to make the process accessible and understandable to people so that if they self-represent or do so with assistance that's less, something less than full-on representation, they can be successful in their litigation. So for example, cases where individuals have been married for a relatively shorter period of time, 3 or 4 years. Maybe there are no children involved. There are not a lot of assets to divide. There's not going to be a claim for spousal support, but you have to go to court to get a divorce. You can't do it on your own. You have to get the sanctioning and imprimatur of a divorce decree from a court. Those are situations where a simplified process, and some jurisdictions do have that, a simplified process can be utilized by individuals without needing legal assistance. And you may not even need a lot of technology for that. That might be a situation where well-created forms are sufficient for people to pick up, read through the instructions, fill them out, and submit them to the court, and maybe have someone look over that for them rather than necessarily having to have technical assistance in the form of a computer program to satisfy that need to get a divorce decree. So yes, I think there are things we can do short of technology. I think the challenge is identifying the areas that we can carve out and the conditions or criteria, circumstances that would warrant a more simplified procedure rather than giving people sort of a watered down justice or an outcome where there are underlying issues that haven't been addressed that will haunt them later down the road.
Thank you. We have a question about pushback from the organized bar to the use of non-lawyers and or informational tools. Chief Justice Marshall, might you make a comment about that?
Certainly. Right across the country, there has been resistance on the part of lawyers to allow, the dean mentioned practicing law without a license. It's a very narrow-minded view. And I think I'm talking to this generation of students to say the very worst thing that you could do is, well, the first thing that is bad is to do nothing, but the worst thing to do is to say, we're not prepared to think about how to deliver this in a different way. We are a very legal society. You heard about the upsides. I've spoken about that earlier. But it also means we do have to go to court. But there are so many ways that you can smooth the way for judges, countless ways. And if this generation of students says, we're going to explore every possible alternative so that we can work with and partner with other professionals, and indeed people from the community, people who know a great deal. For example, in the probate and in our family court, and this will not surprise Professor Brito, over 80% of the cases, there's not a lawyer in the court representing either party. that makes it almost impossible for the judge. It is very helpful for the judge to have before them something that an allied professional can do, simply helping the parties fill out the forms. That is not doing legal advice. I think we are on the cusp of a great change. The profession is going to change. And I think there's a generation of students who really need to do it. I want to say one other thing as well, if I can, in response to one of the other questions that was raised earlier. And I speak here particularly to the deans and to the professors. Leadership, 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 leadership. If it comes from the voice of the dean, if the dean is solidly behind innovative practices, that'll have a ripple effect all the way through. If you have a hesitant dean or a professor who's sort of not quite there, it really does have a chilling effect. I should say, Dean Minow, that your deanship, and I don't say this because you're on the panel with me, made such a difference because you spoke with such a clear voice about access to justice. And we see what a huge difference, and I can see Dean Perlman is nodding his head. I know that at the Supreme Judicial Court, every time I invited people to come and talk to about access to justice, you were there. That made a big difference to have the Dean of the Harvard Law School as a solid advocate for this. So every one of us, in whichever way we can, I think can point to a new way, different in many cases. And I just loved listening to the deans and the professions and the professors today. So thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for those kind words. There's another question that asks, again, how to make the case to deans who haven't adopted this as a priority. And how are law students responding to learning to be project managers or being told to work on technology when they thought they were becoming lawyers? Another that I'll just bundle in this group is, what about all the people who've already graduated from law school and haven't learned how to use technology or to be project managers and so forth? And Andy, maybe you'll say something about this.
Yeah, I'll take that one. On the latter issue, all the graduates out there, it's a question I hear all the time when I talk about legal innovation and technology. It's one of the reasons that we launched that online certificate program that I described in legal innovation and technology, because there wasn't any place for graduates to go to learn more about the knowledge and skills that they need to navigate this new world. As for students, it's not like we have to push it on them. They're embracing it in a lot of respects because they see that the job market is changing and they care very deeply about having successful careers. And they see the writing on the wall. Even if they're going to pursue a traditional career as a lawyer, they see clients who want their lawyers to be able to be better, faster, and cheaper. They see their law firms insisting that lawyers become more efficient, especially as the billable hour model is starting to change and there are more alternative fee agreements that are used. So, and students are also seeing opportunities for new jobs that didn't exist 5 or 10 years ago. I'll just give one short, quick anecdote. When we created our Legal Innovation and Technology Certificate Program, I got a call, this is before I became dean, I got a call from a prominent law firm in the Northwest. And remember, we're in Boston. A law firm in the Northwest called us up and said, we're looking to hire a legal solutions architect, somebody who can marry legal knowledge with legal innovation and technology. And they couldn't find anyone at law schools anywhere in the country who had the relevant skill set. So they reached out to me thousands of miles away to see if we had anybody. And they hired one person and then they hired several more over the years. And students see that. And so they see where the market is going. And so they're moving in this direction. So it's a way to respond for those deans out there. Why do you want to build this? Well, because it ultimately helps your students and graduates and makes a difference in terms of access to justice.
That's fantastic. I will in a second turn things back to David Oxtoby, our president of the Academy. And let me just say, along with my thanks to everyone who is participating, including people whose questions were not addressed, important questions about rural America, about the concept of triage from medical care. There is a hunger to deal with these issues. And the wonderful suggestion from Sarah Davis in the chat to create a way to share innovations, an innovation site We are committed to finding ways to continue this conversation. Thank you all. And David, thank you.
Thank you. It's been a wonderful conversation. We could have gone on for another hour, I'm sure, with some really interesting questions and discussion. And I'd like to thank all of the panelists and speakers, Martha, Andy, Quinten, Tonya, Dayna, and Chief Judge Marshall, for all that you've done for the Academy project, and of course, for leading this fascinating conversation today. And so I'd like to encourage everyone who's participated to explore the full report on our website, www.amacad.org, and consider sharing it with friends and colleagues. And thank you all for joining us. So this concludes an excellent meeting. Thank you all.